thank you. I'm very happy to participate to this session. So I'm Marion Bardet, and I'm going to introduce you the first result of my PhD work on the intestinal changes in horse remains. So we know that since the beginning of their interaction with Earth, equids were closely related to human societies and their various activities. They were exploited for economical and political development, as means of transport, involved in warfare, or, for example, agricultural works. Moreover, they were used for hunting and sport, and most recently as companions and pets. Consequently, a diversity of functions were attributed as monks, draft, or pack animals. Funerary and sacrificial sites are variable contexts for studies of equid-human relationships. The discoveries of complete or partial horse skeletons in or associated with two human tombs reveal the particular bond between this animal and their owners. Unfortunately, if researchers can confirm that they were domesticated, they can only hypothesize about their actual functions. Were they really employed for human activities, and what were their real functions, and what kind of horses were slaughtered? In order to answer these questions, studies of musculoskeletal stress markers on faunal remains have increased in importance. They correspond to osseous changes that occur in response to internal or external factors. And among them, there are the entesial changes, which correspond to bone modification of the attachment sites of muscle, tendons, and ligaments. After three decades since their initial study, they are widely used in physical anthropology for the reconstruction of economical activities, division of labor, and inference of life condition in past societies. Several methods were created in order to study this modification, and the most recent one is the Coimbra method. This kind of analysis of faunal remains is unfortunately much less common, with four publications. Two are dedicated to the horse and two others to the reindeer. And it's because of the lack of the studies and the importance of horses in human societies, we propose to analyze entesial changes in equid remains. Thanks to previous researches on this topic and veterinary data, it's possible to create a recording method adapted to analysis of horse bones. Then, an important part of this work is the establishment of baseline reference sample thanks to documenting modern skeletons. This sample will permit the identification of etiologies that modify the appearance and the development of insertion sites. Our method is focused on fibrocartilaginous anthesis. It's inspired by the recent macroscopical methods published during the last decades for human remains. Observation made thus far on 33 equid skeleton has contributed to the creation of a recording method specific to horses. We record bone modification, microporosities and microparosities, and less common erosion. On the center of the insertion, always at its border. And then we consider the extent of the developmental severity of lesions. We divide the recording system in three scores. The normal enthesis is called as A. A B score is attributed to enthesis with slightly or moderate alteration. And enthesis with a severe lesion is called as C. Here, we consider 28 fibrocartilaginous enthesis located on the appendicular skeletons. 16 are located on the forelimb, on the scapula, humerus, radulina, and phalanges, and 12 others on the posterior limb, located on the coxa, femur, tibia, and phalange. We consider the right and the left side, as well as the medial and the lateral position of the collateral ligaments of the interphalangeal joints. So a total of 56 entheses per skeleton are recorded for one individual. Our sample is composed of 41 skeletons of documented modern horses. These animals are curated in various institutions as museums and veterinary schools. There are 29 non-working horses. These 12 males, 16 females, and unigelding lived in enclosure, like zoo. They are between 5 and 35 years old. And on the other side, we have 12 horses as working horses. 8 of them are used as mounts, and four of them as draught horses. This group is composed of 9 males and 3 females, aged between 5 and 29 years old. Unfortunately, we don't have any pack equids. Here, this histogram shows us the percentage of healthy entheses in white and altered entheses in blue. In this analysis and the next, we group the B and C score because we know that the C score, the well-developed modification, show low frequencies. And in each group, the horses are ranged in function of age. We can see that the distribution of normal and abnormal entheses varies from an equid to another. For some of them, the frequency of altered insertion is greater than the frequency of normal one, for example, this one. And conversely, some show low percentage of entheses, for example, this one. And it's this result reveals the existence of inter-individual variability in the development of entheses changes, and it's the reason why we test the possible influence of various factors on the development of lesions. Is there an influence of age or sex? Is it possible to differentiate non-working and working horses? And is it possible to distinguish the different activities at the riding and draft horses? In this study, we note that the development of entheses changes is symmetrical, so in the next analysis, we grouped the left and the right side. So first, we test the influence of age on the development of modification. The sample is divided in two class age. The horses which are 15 years old or less are in blue, and the horses of more than 15 years old are in red. We are focused on the difference in the percentage of lesions for each entheses in each age group. We note, the entheses on the anterior limb are here, and the entheses on the posterior limb are here. We note that for most of the insertion, the percentage of alteration is greater in horses of more than 15 years old. 7 entheses of the forelimb and 7 entheses of the posterior limbs are significantly different between the group. So we can conclude that there is an influence of increasing age on the development of entheses modification, and 40 entheses are particularly impacted by this parameter. So we know that throughout life, the whole skeleton is exposed to internal and external stress, and that could explain the high frequencies of modification in old horses. Here we test the influence of sex on entheses changes, and in order to exclude the impact of age on this analysis, we consider only the young adults. For most of the entheses, percentage of lesions are greater in male, which are in red, and than in female, which are in blue. 3 entheses of the forelimb and 5 of the posterior limb expose percentage of alteration significantly different between the sexes. So we can conclude that there is a sex-linked effect on the development of modifications, particularly for 8 entheses. And generally, males show more modifications than do females. But for the moment, even if we know that there is weak sexual dimorphism in horses, we can't give a precise explanation for this result. So then we compare the influence of non-working and working horses on development of entheses changes. Young and old horses were considered. Working horses in red show, in most of cases, larger frequencies of alteration than non-working horses in blue. 7, anthesis of the forelimbs and 5 of the posterior limb, expose percentage of alteration significantly different. But what is interesting, we can note that the insertion of the collateral ligament on the humerus and the biceps brachii on the radius are not affected by this parameter. We can conclude it's possible to distinguish non-working and working equids, particularly with these both antheses, which show more lesion in domesticated horses. This difference could be due to the fact that they were more exposed to physical strains that induced increasing enthesial changes. The non-working horses, which live in our closure, probably didn't move as much as the domesticated ones. And then we compare the percentage of abnormal antheses between the riding horses in blue and the draft horses in red. We can note that the antheses are actually altered in draft horses here. And the most of the frequencies are between 15% and 100%, and the percentage are lower for mounts. If the difference between draft and mounted horse is very high, 5 antheses of the anterior limb and 2 of the posterior limb are significantly different. And it's interesting to note that the infraspinatus on the humerus is not influenced by age or sex. So it could be possible then to reveal distinction between mounts and draft horses, particularly thanks to due changes of the insertion of the infraspinatus muscle. However, we can note that the sample is unequal. Moreover, the number of draft horses is fewer than the sample on mounted equids, so we opt to increase the number of specimens for each group in the future. Concerning the identification of activity, we test parameters linked to the position of insertion. In fact, in the veterinary data, based on the sports horse, they suggest that there is a high incidence of lesions on tendons and ligaments of phalanges. In fact, depending on the activity practiced, for example, event or race, there are differences between between anterior limb and posterior limb, and medial and lateral position of the collateral ligaments on the phalange. So that's why we test this criteria on the insertion of the collateral ligaments of the medial and distal interphalangeal joints. During this analysis, we note that there is no difference between the forelimb and the hind limb in the non-working and draft horses. But there is a significant difference for the insertion of the collateral ligament on the second phalange for the mounted horses. In fact, the attachment of the anterior limb show high frequencies of anomaly compared to the posterior limb. Unfortunately, we don't note any difference between medial and lateral collateral ligaments in the fore and the hind limb. To conclude, the study demonstrates the nature of enthesial changes of horse remains. Thanks to the creation of our baseline reference sample, we highlighted the inter-individual variation for the development and enthesial changes in our sample. It can be partly explained by the influence of age and sex. So, as in physical anthropology, we need to consider this parameter for the next analysis. We note that the domesticated horses expose more alteration than non-working ones. And we note that 2 antheses of the forelimbs could permit to distinguish non-working and working horses. Then, draft horses show very high frequencies of antheseal changes that could be used to detect them in archaeological context compared to the riding horses. Changes in 2 antheses appear to be particularly important in order to distinguish between riding and draft horses. Then, these first results are very useful for work on archaeological context to infer activity patterns and help us in our interpretation. Thank you very much.